Okay, we can get started. Good afternoon, everybody. So it's a pleasure for me to welcome all of you to today's program and to ICTP. Some of you are joining from Zoom, so joining ICTP remotely, but it's already nice to see that we are returning more and more to a normal situation post-COVID. And it's a particular pleasure for ICTP because ICTP has been a founding partner of the International Year for Basic Sciences for Sustainable Development 2022. And as part of that commitment, we have planned a series of activities during the year, including panel discussions and keynote talks related to this theme throughout the year. And this is the first of this series. So I'm very happy that we have a really an excellent program today, particularly relevant for this international year, talking about the importance of basic sciences in addressing the global energy crisis, which clearly is a major challenge for all of us. And it will focus on how basic science can help to bring renewable energy conversion to the forefront of world's future energy landscape. And we have some of the world experts in this field. I'm very pleased to have here Professor Richard Catlow. He's an expert in solid state chemistry and material science at University College London, and co-president of InterAcademy Partnership. You will hear more technical, more scientific introduction later in the when the talk the speakers are introduced. And we also have Patchanita Thamyongkit, he's expert in photovoltaics from Chulalongkorn University, joining us remotely from Thailand, a former ICTP prize winner. So we are very happy to have these two speakers today. And the discussion will be moderated by ICTP graduate diploma program alumnus, Stephane Kenmoe, who is now a scientist at the University of Duisburg-Essen. And his research focuses on computational descriptions of photovoltaic water splitting, so related to this theme. So if you are joining online, please don't hesitate to write your questions in the chat, and they will be addressed after the presentations. I'm also very happy that we will be joined today by Michelle Spiro, who is the president of IYBSSD, the International Year for Basic Sciences for Sustainable Development 2022. It's a major important year approved by the United Nations, and the efforts of Professor Spiro were really central to making it happen. So I give the floor to Michelle now.
Hello. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I hope you can hear me. So dear colleagues, dear participants, thank you very much, Atish and ICTP, for organizing this event on the importance of basic sciences in addressing the global energy crisis. This fits perfectly well with the goals of the International Year of Basic Sciences for Sustainable Development, IYBSSD 2022. The opening ceremony of this international year will only be on July 8th, at UNESCO headquarters due to the late proclamation by the United Nations General Assembly on December 2nd last year. But since you were ready before the date of the opening ceremony, your event, this event, is already part of the international year. By the way, just to inform you, the closing ceremony is expected to be held in the third quarter of 2023, so a little bit more than 1 year after the opening ceremony, at CERN, in the new building dedicated to basic sciences, the Science Gateway, designed by the famous Italian architect Renzo Piano. So 2023 will also be used to organize events. This is for you. If you want to go on in 2023, you are welcome. Basic sciences and curiosity-driven sciences constantly re-enchant our world and contribute to make it desirable and sustainable. Fired up by the desire to understand our world, each generation throughout history has added to the well of knowledge built up by previous generations, from which subsequent generations are able to draw their inspiration, the inspiration they need to solve the problems they face. It is the exact opposite of what we are currently doing with our planet's natural resources. Basic sciences, curiosity-driven, are the sources of discoveries which turn into applications which serve an inclusive, sustainable development, which all together, discoveries, applications, and inclusive sustainable development, must boost collaborative and open basic sciences. This is a virtuous circle that we want to promote. This process should involve scientists, private sector, decision makers, and the society at large. This should apply, obviously, to the global energy crisis. For this, basic sciences must be funded and used for education. ICTP, which is emblematic of basic sciences, must be supported and continue its mission of research, education, and multicultural dialogue. Long life to ICTP, long life to basic sciences, and to sustainable development. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Michel. Now I give the floor to Amal Kasri. She's joining us from UNESCO. She's the chief of section there in the capacity building in basic sciences. Again, very closely related to this theme and a close partner of ICTP. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Atish. Good afternoon, everyone. Good morning also for those who have the morning. Dear esteemed colleagues and distinguished professors, it gives me a great pleasure to join you today in one of the activities celebrating the International Year of Basic Sciences for Sustainable Development. As you all know, UNESCO is the only organization in the United Nations family which has science inscribed in its name. Its first director general, Julian Huxley, was actually an eminent zoologist, and he was committed to the popularization of science. And from the beginning, UNESCO recognized the importance of making official contact with the international scientific societies in order to promote scientific cooperation across the boundaries of nations and of bringing together scientists and others concerned with the applications of science. UNESCO remains well placed to proclaim the message that access to scientific and technological progress is a human right, and that human rights must be at the center of science's priorities. UNESCO's commitment now as ever is to put science and the technology at the service of the welfare of people everywhere to eradicate poverty and to ensure sustainable development for all. As you heard from Michelle, as proclaimed by the United Nations General Assembly as the International Year of Basic Science for Sustainable Development, 2022 will be the ultimate chance to try to achieve important goals such as strengthening science education and training, increasing the access to basic science funding resources, and promoting open science. These are among several other goals, all of which serve to raise the awareness of the role of basic sciences in improving people's lives, specifically when we are facing a global pandemic, for example, and thus achieving sustainable development goals. This year will be a great opportunity to promote inclusive collaboration in fundamental research by fostering gender-balanced and geographically diverse networks. This year will promote capacity development opportunities, as well as formal and informal education activities in the basic sciences. It will also organize major conferences and workshops in different parts of the world, and in particular in developing countries. It will advertise existing or new initiatives of all sorts, distributed all over the world. And we all hope that this will result in catalyzing basic science related in developing countries, which could be helped and supported and also celebrated regularly even after the year of the International Year of Basic Science. We will inaugurate the year on the 8th of July 2022 here at the headquarters of UNESCO in Paris. And this event will bring together policymakers, scientists, and the private sector with inclusive coverage from both gender and geographical perspectives, as well as the public at large. We will try to put the spotlight on the links between basic sciences and sustainable development goals, which will be a key moment to convince economic and political leaders, as well as the public, of the importance of investing in basic science. Dear colleagues, I invite you all to join us on the 8th of July. And even if you cannot join us, I urge you to take the opportunity and to deliver a loud and a clear message that we need to sustain basic science research in order to sustain our lives. Thank you very much, and I'm looking forward to listening to Professor Catlow and Professor Thamyongkit. And I would like to thank our colleagues at the ICTP for organizing this event. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Amal. Now I give the floor to Kenmoe, who will be the moderator.
Oh. Thanks, Atish. So it's a privilege to me, for me today to moderate this event, which is full of significance. So before starting with the panelists, before they share their rich experience about renewable energies, so I will just have us, want us to have a glance at what is happening in Africa, what is the potential in renewable energy, what can be done, and then what are the rooms for making the world better. So I'm Stephane, alumni from ICTP Condensed Matter Diploma Program, actually presently in Germany. So this year is dedicated to basic science, as stated by the United Nations. And whenever we write publications, we who are dealing with renewable energy, there's always a sentence that comes back. So we study, we do this study, this research, because renewable energy is an environmentally friendly alternative to fossil fuels and so on and so forth. This comes over, right? But actually renewable energy has established itself like an urgent necessity, right? To get peace, freedom, and justice in the world. Peace because the scarcity fossil fuels, right, can lead to social instabilities as we see in Europe actually. And also for freedom, because many states, country now understand the necessity to reduce their dependency on external supply, which is actually still fossil fuels, which constitute 80% of the energy supply in the world. And also for justice and equity. You see, this is an image in Cameroon. That image here, this one here on the right. This is a village somewhere where I was born in Cameroon, from Gaoundéré to Garoua in the north of Cameroon. You see, the electrical power is just passing on top of the village. You can imagine what people in this village can go to, right? So 12 out of 17 of the SDG goals can be achieved in this place, right? From education, access to healthcare, food or stuff like that. So renewable energy is a solution to achieve at least 12 of these SDG goals. So, and then there's a lot of room in Africa, right? To use renewable energy to improve the condition of people. There's still, according to the African Development Bank, I think 1,500 gigawatt of unexploited potential in renewable energy. And then this includes hydropower, wind, solar energy, or other types of energy like geothermal energies and so on. And then you see in red, this is the untapped potential, right? For each of these categories. You can see that for hydropowers, which actually has been the commonly used source of energy in Africa for years, for decades now, because of the continuous drought across the continent, the hydropower is not more reliable, right? It's not more an energy on which people can count fully, because also there's a problem in the transport. So because the distribution networks is aged and saturated. And then this leads to 30% lost in the electricity capacity. And then for people who go to Africa, Ralph and Nicola, we were in Chang, right? You can stay for days without electricity, right? So you know the reality. And then also for wind, wind energy is booming in Africa, particularly in East Africa. You see, this is, for example, a wind power farm in Kenya, right? And Africa is a potential place to promote wind energy because of the geographic landscape. There are many places with good geographic landscape that can promote the high speed of the wind and also the efficient pressure gradient, which are the ingredients that we need to make good use of wind energy. So another one is the solar power, the power from solar energy. You see, this is, for example, the distribution. You can see that the solar capital of Africa is high compared to other countries or places in the world. And then Africans are making good benefit of it. You see, for example, in Morocco. In Morocco, we have the largest concentrated solar power plant, which produces around 60 megawatts of energy. And then this is nothing compared to the 1,000 gigawatts of untapped solar potential. Apart from these sources, there's also photocatalytic chemical energy conversion, right? The recent progress in basic science have shown that one can achieve a lot, right, using the sun energy. And then this is where basic science come, because basic science can help to tune or to make good use to allow a rational production of energy and an efficient use. For example, for those dealing with heterogeneous catalysis like me or other panelists, basic science is very important for the efficient material characterization, rational design of catalysts, improvement of property to improve the chemical energy conversion and storage, and to reduce the loss of efficiency. This is, for example, in case of solar cell, when you move from cells to modules, there is the loss of efficiency. And then basic science is important, right, to tackle this issue. So these are just some of the various points. And then the question is, okay, what's happening in Africa with all this potential? Why are things not moving? The answer is simple, is in this distribution that you can see. This is how much countries in the world are investing into science. You see Italy is somewhere around 2, Germany, United States, South Korea is of course on top. And then you see that if you search for African countries here, you will just see countries from the South, South Africa namely, and then country from the Maghreb. So this is actually Morocco, Egypt. And then this clearly explains why the contribution of Africa in the scientific research, which is actually between 1% and 2% in the world, is polarized. It comes mainly from the northern part and the southern part of Africa. So there's a lot to do, right, to make people invest into science. And then it's not just by driving the political will, right, to invest in fundamental science. The East African Institute of Fundamental Science is the pride of ICTP. Right, when you talk with people like Sandro Scandolo, he will always tell you that it's going well in Rwanda, but he seems to forget that President Kagame was standing here where I stand today. He was sitting there, and then he talked with Professor Quevedo and about the importance of basic science. And then Rwanda had his first program of master in physics just in 2014 or 15, if I remember. And then 7 years after, Rwanda is booming. Then what is the answer? The answer is the political will, but the political will is not everywhere in Africa. So Africa is driven by the urgent need to innovate because of problem, hunger, poverty, and stuff like that. So people have to act, engage, and this is what I do personally on the personal point of view, because I'm heading a project which is dedicated to build capacity in fundamental science, to involve decision makers, local authorities, like we did in Chang with Ralph and Nicola. We talked to decision makers about the importance. They have to value science. The dress that Ralph is wearing with Nicola here, in my culture, this means that you are a noble, right? You do something which is noble. So the king, by giving this dress to Nicola and Ralph, he's just in front of Nicola here, is to say to Nicola and Ralph that you did the right, so they are value basic science. Then they can talk to authorities or political leaders whenever they come for elections. So this is a trick also. This is a social political approach that we hope will bring some. So we have to go beyond capacity building. And then Professor Covedo said something when Professor Gagami was here that they will help strengthening the continent research capacity. But before strengthening, you have to create vocations and build capacity, right? You see, we only have 200 scientists per million inhabitants in Africa compared to 1,500 in the world. So we still have to create vocation, not only to make them stronger, because in 50 or 40 years, Africa will be 2 billion inhabitants. And then I'm not sure, if you ask me where are the diploma students who were here 10 years ago, many of them left academia, they left basic science, their industry or doing business, doing stuff like that. So I'm afraid that we have, okay, it's not good to say that. So I'm not too optimistic, right, by improving or increasing the number of scientists. So we have to go beyond capacity building and encouraging young African scientists to join topics that align with the local need that we did recently in Kinshasa. We selected Fallon, who joined our university in Duisburg-Essen to work on energy conversion. So what we do is that we also have engagement project, right? We engage celebrity to promote basic science. And what we do is that we come to institutions like ICTP, we talk with scientists about basic science topics, and then we try to disseminate it into movies, right? To touch the society. Because in Africa, it works the other way around. It's when the society is interested that politicians, right, take decisions. So it's not like here. So this is what we have done. We have produced a movie, Science in the City, which talks only about basic science. And then apart from that, we also engage celebrities to go to university to bring scientists out of the lab to make them engage for science. So basic science is not just a matter of scientists, it's a matter of the whole African society that needs to boost the interest to invest into science. So thank you. This is what I wanted to say about Africa. And then today is a privilege for me to introduce two bright scientists, right, with a very important track record, publications, expert in catalysis, synthesis. Today we have somebody who received a knighthood from the Queen Elizabeth II for his important contribution to basic science, engagement, collaboration between institutions. So I have the honor to introduce to you, Sir Richard Catlow.
Well, thank you very much, Stephane, for the introduction. And it's a real great pleasure to be able to speak at this meeting. And I'm very grateful for the invitation. What I'm going to try and do is just outline some of the very many scientific challenges that will be needed if we're going to achieve sustainability. I'll look at sustainability generally, but we'll have quite a focus on sustainability in energy. You'll see from my various addresses that I've added the InterAcademy partnership, and that's important for this talk. I have the privilege to be one of the co-presidents of the InterAcademy partnership, and the IAP is doing a great deal of work, as I hope to show, that is highly relevant to our discussions today. So just let me first say a few words about the InterAcademy partnership. It's a global network of academies of science, medicine, and engineering, close on 150 members of academies. It has four regional networks, and it can call upon, this is of key importance, 30,000 leading scientists, engineers, and health professionals in over 100 countries. And its secretariat, Trieste Secretariat, is hosted nearby by TWAS and ICTP. And just again, very quickly, what is the IAP trying to do? It's very much trying to build the capacity and empower regional networks of academies and their national members. And following the early discussion, we're very concerned in developing academies in Africa. We want to empower academies to provide really authoritative advice on global, regional, and national issues. Of course, we want to promote in general the importance of science, scientific research, science education, and science literacy in populations at large. And then we want to build the IAP itself to be a more resilient and progressive network. And here's just one example of a recent piece of work, recent output of the IAP, a very major project on a key issue of climate change and health. And this was a kind of global synthesis. Our four regional networks each produced a report focusing on their region, and then we've synthesized that into a global report that will be released very shortly. And there's some details there on the launch event for those of you who are interested. But let me get back to the question of science and sustainability. And in some ways, this slide may be the most important one in my presentation, because I think it's a point that we all as a community need to make. And that is, to achieve sustainability, we need innovation in basic science and technology, of course, together with societal and behavioural change. I say this because I have heard on more than one occasion views from very senior people that we do actually have the scientific knowledge we need now to achieve sustainability, including sustainability in energy. And essentially what we need is development and deployment, but that, quite frankly, simply isn't true. And I've added here that innovation in physics, chemistry and materials science will be essential. I hope to show that during this talk. Of course, innovation in many other areas will be as well, but these are disciplines that I know something about. Now, a few words about sustainability. Here are a few important definitions. I really like the one on the top left there: ability to provide the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations. And economic development, social development, environmental protection, they're all interdependent. And emphasizing that natural resources should be used at a rate that doesn't deplete supplies over the long time. And then residues shouldn't be unmanageable. So these are really important points. And of course, we've already mentioned in Stefan's presentation the key importance of the SDGs and the fact that science and scientific innovation will contribute to the realization of many of them. And again, now returning to the IAP, IAP has done important work in this field. We had a quite substantial project on improving scientific input to global policymaking with a focus on the SDGs. And this was aiming to mobilize its members to really focus on this issue, including the growing number of young academies. And I think this has had real impact, but it's work in progress. And the report urges everyone to engage openly and inclusively with this important field. And here's another one, again, perhaps relevant to Stefan's presentation, a project we finished about 3 or 4 years ago on harnessing science, engineering, and medicine to address Africa's challenge. I think Stefan has shown how crucially important this is. And this report made the case for strengthening the science policy interface in Africa, particularly to accelerate the SDGs and the Africa Union's SDI strategy for Africa. Well, again, let me now return again to the scientific themes. These are some of the ones, I probably won't be able to talk about them all, but some of the ones I'd like to say a few words about. I'll talk a little bit about the circular economy, the science that would be needed there, the challenge of biomass, many, many major challenges, decarbonisation of transport, a crucial issue, sustainable nitrogen fixation, that is often not realised how important that is. And then finally, if I have time, the importance in discussing all these issues to do what is called life cycle analysis. Let's look at the circular economy. And again, things are going to try and talk about linearity versus circularity, green chemistry, the whole issue of plastics that we hear so often. How can we achieve a circular plastics economy? And the challenges relating to CO2. Now, here is what the contrast between the linear and the circular economy. On the left is what we're doing at present. Essentially, we take raw materials, we process them into various goods, we use them or consume them, and then we dispose of waste. And that's not entirely what we do at present, but it is largely. We need to move to what's on the right-hand side. We need with biosystems to make, consume, and then enrich the next cycle. We need with technical materials to make, use, and then return. And these are easy to say, but they are major challenges. And again, the IAP has made, I think, a significant contributions to policy relating to the circular economy. I'm here highlighting work of ESAC, that's the European Academies Science Advisory Council, our European regional network, 2016, it produced two reports on the circular economy relating to critical materials and indicators, and then a more recent report on packaging plastics in the circular economy, and then examined some of the key issues relating to trying to achieve a circular economy with plastics. Green chemistry, I've mentioned, and this is a major movement. My chemistry is the core of my scientific expertise, and the movement to green chemistry is one of the most important developments in the last 20 years in the discipline. What do we need to do? Replace traditional chemical technologies by greener alternatives, employing catalytic technologies. And you'll hear me shortly say quite a lot about catalysis. Secondly, absolutely crucial, we need to move from fossil-based to renewable bio-based manufacture. People don't always realize that, as well as depending to a large extent, but to a declining extent, on fossil carbon for fuels, we depend on fossil carbon for a great deal of our manufactured goods, and we're going to have to move away from that. And then we need to move again away from the linear economy to a circular economy, which builds in circularity throughout the whole process. Now, again, and let me draw attention to relevant work of the IAP, IANAS, that's the InterAcademy Network of Academy of Sciences of the Americas, a report that provides science-based analysis of the current energy situation in the Americas and looks to the future. This is a book, and I think a very relevant and important book. Let me now return to plastics, and I'm going to here use a number of slides that were given to me by a very good friend and colleague, Matt Davidson from the University of Bath, who leads a major centre concerned with developing sustainable technologies, particularly in the chemicals industry. Now, some of the statistics on plastic utilisation are pretty stunning. 1 million plastic bottles bought globally every minute, and that's an amazing statistic. And then another one, each person on the planet will generate twice their body weight in plastic waste every year by 2050. That's if we have the kind of business as usual scenario. Here is some more data. We're comparing where we are, this is a few years ago, actually 2014, with 2050 for a number of things. Plastic production would triple unless things change. One I really like here, ratio of plastics to fish in the ocean by weight, and at present it's a fish are five times the weight, global weight of fish in the ocean, five times out of plastics. 2050, business as usual, it would be 1-to-1. Very big increase in the component of oil and the what is known as the carbon budget. So what are we doing at present? We're doing something that isn't particularly circular at all. This again is a little bit older data, 2013, it will be higher now. 28 million tons annual production. A lot of that goes into landfill, 40%. Some of it's incinerated to generate energy. Quite a lot goes into leakage, just gets generally dispersed, including in the oceans. About 14% collected for recycling. Statistics will have improved over the last 7 or 8 years, but still we'll find those landfill, incineration, leakage are pretty high. This is what we need to move to. We need to have the majority recycled. We can reuse some plastics, and we need to change the feedstock, something I'll come back to later on. Now, it's easy to say this. How do we do it? There are technical challenges in all these technical challenges in recycling, in reuse, in design and production. And these will require basic science, which is a really important point. They will require basic science, not just development, for their solution. We will need catalytic technologies. We need energy efficient processes. We need to use earth abundant materials, catalysts, self-healing materials, programmed degradation, chemical recycling, and design, of course, very important, design for reuse and recycling. So there are some really basic challenges here across a broad spectrum, I say, including design. Let me move on to CO2, CO2 challenge. Now, we're all aware of the CO2 challenge as it relates to climate. I'll say just very briefly, but there are other issues we need to think about CO2. We are almost certainly going to need carbon dioxide as a carbon source. And we're going to need, I think it's very unlikely that the world will be able to move entirely away from hydrocarbon fuels. So we will need sustainable hydrocarbon fuels. Now, just a word, this is something you all know. CO2 challenge, climate change in carbon flows. We need a drastic reduction in CO2 emissions. This is just showing you some of the scenarios. If we're going to keep temperature increases within a manageable limits by 2050. So this is well known. I'm not going to dwell on it. What I will dwell on is these other aspects, the CO2 challenge. We will need carbon dioxide to become a carbon source to make chemicals and fuels. As I said, many of the materials we use require carbon. Fabrics that we're wearing do. Most of the carbon sources, of course, some are bio sources, but most of the other carbon sources are from fossil fuels, and we will need to replace them. Also, I think we will need technologies, there's developments here for carbon capture and utilization, but again, more basic science and technology. Now, enabling science, the key rubs, sorry to keep coming back to catalysis, but this is just giving you one example of a really key basic science challenge. That is carbon dioxide hydrogenation. I hope to get effectively carbon dioxide to react with hydrogen to produce useful molecules, to use it as a carbon source. And there are groups all around the world working on this challenge. I'd like to give you some snippets of science during this talk. So I'm going to give you one, which I think is, can only say a few words about here, a really beautiful piece of science. And this is looking at what iron and iron nickel catalysts for carbon dioxide hydrogenation. It's work of a group that was at Cardiff University. It's now at the University of Leeds, headed by Professor Nora DeLu. And what they're trying to do is to use CO2, as a carbon source, produce useful chemicals, formic acid, methanol, and they're going to use these iron nickel catalysts, which I'll not go through. These have a number of advantages. They're earth abundant and they're non-toxic, and they have a number of specific chemical advantages, which will make you think they could be good catalysts. Now, what is a really neat thing about this work is that it was bio-inspired. It started from the things that are shown on this slide. On the ocean bed, you get what are called hydrothermal vents, where hot water is issued. And surrounding those, you get iron sulfides. And also surrounding them, you get a lot of the basic molecules that are building blocks of the molecules of life. And so it's been speculated that the origin of life is associated with these hydrothermal vents. That's a very speculative argument. The other interesting thing you see is that some of biological, what we call hydrogenases, these are biological catalysts that will react hydrogen, will use hydrogen. They have clusters of iron and sulfur in their center. Those are the active sites that carry out the catalysis. So this set these people thinking. And what they did, they looked very carefully at the structure of the iron and sulfur in these hydrogenases. That's on the right-hand side. The yellows are sulfur, the blue are the iron. And then they looked at the surface of iron sulfide, and they found they were very similar in structure. So then they took these iron sulfides, did a lot of work on them, and they showed that they really worked as these catalysts. They would allow hydrogen to react with CO2 to produce useful molecules, methanol, acetic acid. So a really beautiful piece of basic science. Before I leave the circular economy, again, here's just those who are interested in plumbing the depths here. This was a volume of Philosophical Transactions, the Royal Society, based on an excellent discussion meeting based in the Society about 2 or 3 years ago. A few words about biomass. And again, here I should thank another very good colleague of mine, Chris Hardacre from the University of Manchester, who has done excellent work in this field. Now, again, just to remind you what we're doing at present, what we need to move to. On the top left-hand side, we have an oil refinery. That's what we're using at present, again, very much for our carbon sources and for our fuels. We need to move to a biorefinery where the input is not fossil fuels, the input is biomass. But there are major, fundamental, basic scientific issues here. Now, just to remind you, we need to be more sustainable. Actually, with current fossil fuel transformations and the use of renewables. Now, just again, I don't want to burden you with too much chemistry. What, again, some of the basic challenges? If you look, in this very, very general terms, what we get from fossil fuels, we get hydrocarbons, molecules made out of carbon and hydrogen. What do we get from biomass? We get carbohydrates on the whole. So we had carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. And this again is going to require really good basic science. We're going to have to use, if we want to replace the fossil fuel feedstocks, we're going to have to do something about these oxygenated molecules. And again, a lot of people are working on that. Here's another big challenge with biomass, and that is the possible antithesis between the use of biomass as food and the use as fuels. And that's been very, very widely debated. But if you look at what's happening in the field now, the emphasis is growing on the utilization of waste biomass in response to that challenge. Now, again, just a little snippet of science. Let's look at biodiesel again. Biodiesel, an important important process, one of growing importance. This transforms bio oils into biodiesel. Bio oils are what we call these triglycerides. So just three long molecules linked together, and you wreck them with methanol. I'm not going into detail. Essentially, you break them down and into the biodiesel. But you produce this molecule called glycerol, which is a waste product. And that actually has been a real problem. Now, some of my colleagues at the University of Cardiff came up with something really neat. They took this waste glycerol, they developed a catalytic process that converts it back to methanol. So you can continue the cycle there. You've developed a circular cycle. So a really neat piece, again, of basic science. Now, and I want to move on to decarbonisation of transport, obviously absolutely vital as we move to sustainable energy. And I'll talk a bit first about high energy density batteries, and then a few words about an increasingly topical area of developing sustainable aviation fuel. Now, again, IAP has been active in this field. This is very recent work. The IAP and the Network of African Sciences, Science Academies, NASAC, that's our African regional network, we carried out an 18-month study to consider the issues relating to decarbonisation of transport in the continent. And the report is now available. And the workshop, we had a very, very interesting and successful workshop last November that's produced a report, highlighted the increasing trend in transport demand, motorization, CO2 emissions, but some of the promising initiatives across the continent. And it did again highlight some of the major challenges. Africa is going to need far more transport as the population expands and the economy expands, but we need to do that in a sustainable way. Let me say a few words about batteries for electric cars. I think these are data, by the way, for the UK transport, 30% of CO2 emissions. Note that in the UK, 90% of car journeys are less than 30 miles, so very appropriate for electrification. Now, we use, as you all know, in electric cars, we use batteries. And just a few words about the way in which the science of batteries has developed over the last 220 years. It was founded, of course, by Alexander Volta with his then revolutionary voltaic pile. This really interesting piece of history of science. Volta's pile enabled a whole range of absolutely breakthrough discoveries, including the discoveries made by Faraday, which led to the electric motor and to the basis of electrical generation. But then with the field evolves over the years, and the real state-of-the-art batteries now are certainly for transport are lithium-based. They have a very high specific energy, energy storage per kilogram, and energy storage per volume. So these are, I say, the greatest advance in electrochemistry over the last year. And I just want to talk about one key lithium-ion battery. This is the lithium cobalt oxide system. This was, the basic science here was developed by John Goodenough and his team when John was working at the University of Oxford around 40 odd years ago. And it's simple chemistry, you know, an anode on the right-hand side with lithium intercalated in graphite, and as the battery discharges, lithium ions move across and they kind of intercalate into between the layers of this cobalt oxide. So pretty simple but neat chemistry, and the electrons go around and provide your electric current. If I lecture quite a lot to young people, including teenagers, and if I want to show to them the absolutely vital importance of science, I point to this because we couldn't have mobile phones or laptops without the batteries that were developed by Goodenough's technology. And since people of that age can't imagine life without phones or laptops, it really brings it home to them. The other thing I want to say is I was actually around when this key discovery was made. I was a research fellow working in the chemistry department in the University of Oxford. I knew people in Goodenough's group who were working on this. I wasn't involved. We all recognize it as a really neat piece of science. Nobody appreciated the impact this would have, the impact it would have on consumer electronics. So a beautiful example of how basic science has a huge impact that wasn't anticipated at the time. So the lithium cobalt oxide, that started the whole thing off. A huge amount of work, again, very, very nice science around the world on trying to, there are some disadvantages of this cobalt oxide cathode, trying to get improved cathode materials, transition metal oxides. I'll just give you one example, again, pioneered by John Goodenough, a lithium iron phosphate, lovely material. And one of my colleagues, Saif al-Islam, at the University of Bath, now the University of Oxford, has done elegant computer modeling work, which allow us to understand why this works so well. So as batteries, again, an area where we need, the whole battery area needs more basic science. It needs more basic science for the batteries used in transport, and it needs unquestionably more basic science for batteries used in large-scale energy storage. A word here about sustainable aviation fuel, because there's growing discussion of this. It's a key topic of interest. Lots of proposed alternative fuels. There's a lot to be considered here. We need to think about safety. We need to think about airport handling of the fuel, and then just some kind of economic aspect. A new plane that's delivered today will fly for 20, 30 years. So there are legacy fuel requirements. If we move to non-hydrocarbon fuels, we'll need new airframes. And this could take many, many years to design and to be certified. So there are some real issues here. Then there is the issues of energy density. I'm plotting energy density here, both by volume and by mass. The main take-home message from this is you look at the systems that are the fuels that have, or the energy sources that have high energy density. They're all hydrocarbon-based up on the top right-hand side, kerosene, petroctane, and energy density for particularly for long-haul aircraft, absolutely crucial, and liquid hydrocarbons are the best option. We need a new route to sustainable kerosene. This was the conclusion of a Royal Society policy briefing published about a couple of years ago. I can make that available for those of you who are interested. But again, we need more basic science. Now, my final little snippet of science, which actually is work that I've been involved in, and this is towards sustainable nitrogen fixation. Now, what do we do at present? We use, for the physicists amongst you to impose all this chemistry on you, but this is pretty simple chemistry. We use the Haber-Bosch process. Now, this was an absolute landmark in catalytic science. Essentially, what the Haber-Bosch does, it catalyzes the reaction between nitrogen and hydrogen to make ammonia. And once you've got ammonia, you've fixed nitrogen, you can go on, you can go and make fertilizers or whatever. Now, if you want another, here is another of my impact, of vital impact to science. This is a correct statistic that about the nutritional requirements of something like half the world's population, half the global population, are dependent on nitrogen fixed by the Haber-Bosch process. So quite honestly, if we didn't have this catalytic technology, we simply couldn't support the current global population with reasonable nutrition. So absolutely crucial. We now understand how this happens very, very, very well. It requires really intense conditions. You need high temperature, you need high pressure, it consumes a lot of energy. So we want to move away, we want to try and find something else that will do this, that doesn't require, although it's been absolutely vital for the world over the last 100 years, we need to try and move, at least partially move away. Why is it so difficult? It's so difficult because it's absolutely brute force. I sometimes refer to it as sledgehammer chemistry. What happens? We know the mechanism now very well. The first thing you have to do is to break this nitrogen N2 molecule into two nitrogen atoms. And the nitrogen molecule is this, I'll finish in a minute, is the strongest bond in chemistry. So you're really fighting against basic chemistry here. Now, what we've done, we've moved away from that. This is a catalyst developed by some of my colleagues, and we now understand how it works. What this does, it allows you to start adding hydrogen atoms before you break that bond, and you can do it under much milder conditions. So again, not at all industrial process here, basic science that hopefully will make a big difference to this hugely important area. I'm not going to cover, run out of time, so I'm not going to say much about life cycle analysis, except that it's absolutely vital when you're talking about processes to look at all the aspects, environmental, economic, and social benefits. I just want two final reflections. How do we respond to the basic scientific challenges? We need to use the latest techniques and infrastructure, all the latest developments that science can give us. We need to use all the digital capabilities, and that is unquestionably going to grow. Then we need to collaborate and coordinate. We need to address these. The scientific community needs to work globally to face up to these challenges. And then another final reflections. We spent a huge amount of time thinking and responding, as we had to the COVID challenge. COVID-19 recovery must be green. And returning to the IOP's key message, only a low carbon recovery can generate the co-benefits for social equity, the environment, and human health. Well, finally, many thanks to a lot of people who contributed to this work. I'd particularly like to just draw attention to the last two, Peter McGrath and Giovanni Ottolani, who helped me put this talk together and helped me highlight the relevant work of the IAP. And thank you again for listening. Sorry if I've overrun. And here is just more contact information for the IAP. So thanks very much.
Oh, thank you, sir. You're perfectly in time. So now we travel to Thailand, to Bangkok, to meet who the Nature magazine listed as a rising star 6 years ago. She's an expert in solar-driven energy conversion, a bright and sharp mind, an absolutely brilliant scientist. So I want to introduce Patchanita Thamyongkit from the University of Chulalongkorn, who will try to tell us a bit about her expertise and how the research that she does can contribute to putting the renewable energy at the forefront of the future energy landscape. So the stage is yours, Professor.
Thank you very much for the nice introduction, and thank you for the kind invitation from ICTP to me to join such a special event. And it's always my pleasure to have a chance to contribute in the ICTP stage. And today I am my task is to point out to you how the importance of the basic science in addressing the global energy crisis. And I will introduce myself a little bit more shortly in a later slide. But hang on just a second. Sorry, I cannot click my slide. Oh, okay. So so now let me start with this slide. And because everyone realized now that the world are now suffering from these consequences from the global warming, and many, many countries in the world are committed to the collaboration in the global level to reduce the carbon emission under the Paris Agreement. And the goal is quite aggressive. We would like to reduce the carbon dioxide on carbon emission at least by 40% before 2030, which is not far away from now, and by 100% before 2015, which is quite difficult. Everyone knows that. And all the pressure doesn't come to only to the society, but the industry. They have to consider a lot how to invest, but they cannot avoid that, because now the strict regulation is coming, the trading, the carbon trading, carbon tax is coming. How can they do under the platform, the profit oriented platform? And but anyway, in talking in the positive side, this is a great opportunity to create a partnership between all the stakeholders, not only industry sectors, but also with the climate change organization and the technology developer, like the scientists like us. Okay, so I myself am a scientist, I'm a chemist, focusing on the synthesis of organic material for photo-induced and light harvester, and electrochemical conversion for the green energy production. And now I'm working on the CO2 conversion. And I can say that I'm just like many scientists who want to use advanced material, who want to use the high resolution methods, measurement, and all kinds of technique to make everything perfect. But what interesting in my life is, just recently, just last year, I was invited to be a part of the board member as the independent director in the one of the leading energy company in Thailand, named Ban Pu Power Public Company Limited. And this company is a subsidiary of the coal fire company. You know, they know that they have to move forward in the renewable energy regime. And they now produce and distribute electricity, both from thermal power generation and also renewable power generation. And you can see in this scheme that they try, they put so a lot of effort and intention in expand their business in the renewable energy part, like solar technology, energy storage, e-mobility, and they also have a lot of projects involved in concerning the smart city, energy management, and energy trading. And it's kind of opened my eyes a lot, because by working with them, I can see a lot of motivation from the industry sector, but at the same time, the concern on the investing in the new technology. And it's not easy for the basic scientists like me to give the comments, because I know that on the part of the frontier technology, or we can do everything. But when I have to give the comment, what is optimum? Optimum is not the best. Optimum is most reasonable. What is the optimal option for them under this circumstance? They cannot only consider the efficiency. They have to consider the policy. They have to consider the readiness from the society, from the customer, from the market. And I have to do the simulation in my mind, in my head, what is the best for me, right? So this is kind of a reason why my I put my presentation in the tone like this. So you you can see that what I will present after this will come both from the scientist role and also from the director role, because I think this is the same story. If the technology developer or creator like us know what is the direction or in the whole world in the perspective of marketing or business, we can justify the direction and the level of the technology that is impactful and also practical for the industry sector. Okay, so let me start with this summary from my point of view about the scope of the energy conversion and storage towards the net zero emission goal, right? And what the basic science can do. So we all know that electricity can be produced from many sources, renewable or non-renewable sources, right? And electricity can be transmitted through the line and stored in the battery, which technology is heavily explored and highly developed, right? But at the same time, electricity can be stored in the chemical form, like hydrogen, via the water splitting process, right? And also, hydrogen can be also obtained from the fossil fuel resources. And hydrogen itself can change its form back to give the electricity by fuel cell, right? Everyone knows that. I just give the walkthrough, right? And at the same time, hydrogen, as the Richard just talked about that, the hydrogen can be a main major materials in the hydrogenation of carbon dioxide to produce the fuel product, like all kind of hydrocarbon, which is the same compound that we can get from the petroleum and fossil fuel resources. And with this fuel products, we don't need to change the combustion technology, right? So it means that when we see like this, we can see that we don't have to collect or to store the energy only by battery, but we also, I forgot to mention about solar energy. It can also enhance the water splitting process and also be a part of accelerating the hydrogenation of the carbon dioxide, right? Electricity as well. So to store such a compound is very easy. We can use container. We can deliver it by the pipe or all kinds of logistic or transportation way, right? So by this way, we can see that now is the way to make the electricity low carbon, right? So the energy storage technology becomes the enabler or enabling technology to drive the world to the low carbon society, okay? And how basic science can help? We can help in increasing efficiency. We can help in electrification. How can we change everything? We know how to produce electricity, but how can we make all the application rely on or use electricity as most efficiently and as much as possible so it can blend? Provide a way for the renewable energy to blend in our everyday life, right? And how to make the decarbonize electricity generation, how to manage the carbon, how to make the and energy storage decarbonized too, right? So all of this needs the basic science. And then I can show you now here. I show you now the consumption of the low carbon energy globally, right? So in this case, since I'm from Thailand, this is an Asian country, but anyway, I will have some touch on the European and the cases in America as the role model, because in Europe they have the clear strategy on energy system integration and hydrogen, and in according to the best energy transition performance, the top 9 from 10 countries from Europe. And they are now focusing on the decarbonization technology. So they still need technology, new technology to drive this. And in America, of course, the United States and Canada leads in this region. And they now focus on electrification and hydrogen technology. At the same time, they try to to encourage the company to invest in the renewable energy, carbon dioxide, carbon capture, utilization and storage, or CCUS, and bioenergy. Meanwhile, for the Asian country, we still face the lack of the capital. We need more budget. We still need the clear and strong climate action. We need the infrastructure, regulatory, renewable energy framework and implementation method, which is in the policy level to drive the sustainable transition in Asia. And now in general, we now focus on the solar, wind, coal, biomass and gas, not much on hydrogen, except some country only, like Japan, South Korea and Australia, they are the leader. And we still have the gap between urban and rural area due to the uneven distribution of resources. And this is because we are the region having the rapid growth in manufacturing and transportation sector. So we don't produce our new technology much. And that's mean we have to rely pretty much on the existing energy technology. And if we look up the proportion of the energy generation from fossil fuels, nuclear and renewables energy, I put the dashed line for the world average, all right? We can see that like some European country, especially Sweden, for example, they use very little proportion of the fossil fuel. Now they set up the net zero goal in 2045 and supporting policy from the government agency, right? In Australia, they are the leader. They still have the big proportion of non-renewable energy.
Excuse me, we lost you for 1 minute.
Oh, I'm sorry. What should I do? Can I speak now? Maybe
yes, right? Just lost the connection for 1 minute.
Okay, sorry about that. I will never know. Thank you for telling. So now I can say that in Asian country, we still need to encourage the many all the country to catch up with usage of the renewable energy. The good example is the Vietnam. Like you can see that they, although they are the small country, I'm sorry, what happened? They are small country, but they set themselves as the hub of the Southeast Asia for wind power, for example. And now they create a lot of growth and income because of the wind power, right? And for the Australia, for example, they emphasize a lot on the growth of the renewable energy, but since they are the biggest coal exporter and consumption, they have a lot of resource on this, and they have been long time rely on the coal combustion to catch up, to be net zero and to catch up with the same energy capacity. They have to still do a lot of work with this. And let's get back to the hydrogen. So in here, I can say that hydrogen is considered as the chemical twin of the electricity that can promote the decarbonization in many industrial sectors. And because we don't need, well, we can collect it cheaply in any container and transmit it in a, on the line, in the liquidify form, for example. But to get the electricity back from them, we need the fuel cell. And that is a part of technology that the world needs to be promoted, right? So there are so many kinds of hydrogen from many sources, right? But mainly we categorize it in three according to the how clean it is. So green hydrogen is the new is from the electricity electrolysis of the water, right? So this is a chance to use the renewable energy or the clean energy to do that. And what we get is the pure hydrogen without any contamination from the carbon dioxide or any toxic gas, right? So the world now set it as a new challenging focus towards net zero goal. So many industry I have talked with, they still rely on blue hydrogen because it is it's easy to make and it's still cheap. So at the moment, we still can rely on that, but not for long. It can be only the bridge to establish the hydrogen-based ecosystem. What is the blue hydrogen? It comes from the gray hydrogen, which is hydrogen directly emitted. The hydrogen that comes from the exhausted from the combustion without doing anything. You have the exhausted gas, including hydrogen in there. But if we clean it up a little bit by using the carbon capturing technique, we will get that gas with a higher proportion of the hydrogen. We call it blue hydrogen. So, can you still? Oops. Oh no. How can is this? Can you see? Still hear me?
You just have to, I mean, to put your slides again, because now we are reading your emails.
Oh, I see. So can you see my slide now?
Yes, you can go to presentation mode and then it will be done.
Right, okay, I will continue, okay? For the hydrogen technology, to upgrade the hydrogen to the green level or to the cleaner type, we really rely on the CCUS also. So hydrogen technology and CCUS technology cannot live from each other. Okay, I think you can see from this presentation. And the aggressive growth of the hydrogen technology and the low emission technology can be clearly seen by the growth of the e-mobility business. So we know that now, the many car company, they produce the EV, right? Electric vehicle based on by using the battery, high performance battery, and some of them use the both battery and oil. So the hybrid kind of EV is very popular at the moment as well. They have their highest sale last year, but for the long distance and heavy transportation, the hydrogen give a big advantage because of the high energy density. And it gives the opportunity of many industry and also country to catch up their economies in the vehicle market. And China in Asia, among many Asian country, is the big leader. And we can see in this plot that they have a very successful, very big market share in the EV, both battery EV and hybrid EV. And Europe and USA has a lot already as well. And their success, the success that China has for the battery EV market motivate themselves to enhance the hydrogen adoption in that country. And we can see in this plot that the Asian also take the biggest market share in the fuel cell EV as well. And not only China, but also Japan, they position itself as the hub of the fuel cell technology. And just recently, the South Korea like take over the fuel cell EV market already. And they set up the clear hydrogen economy in their country. Both of these countries, they give a lot of incentive, higher incentive for the fuel cell EV than the battery EV in their country. Okay, and this is the many application of the hydrogen, and with the drive from the carbon capture, utilization, and storage, we can upgrade the hydrogen from blue and gray to the green level, or to make the blue hydrogen more competitive in terms of cost, right? And as I said, the country like Australia, Japan, they put a lot of effort in production. For Australia, they want to export because they have a lot of renewable energy infrastructure and land. But Japan, they don't have a lot of land, but they try to cope with their own domestic needs and try to import it. And now they are the leader of the usage of the liquidified hydrogen.
Excuse me, so can you put your slide in presentation mode?
Okay, yes. Oh, I did not, right?
Yeah.
I can see my, let me stop share and share again. I always see myself as the presentation mode all the time, but I don't know why. Yes. Can you see it now as a presentation mode?
Yeah, all thank right. you.
Sorry, yeah. So for South Korea, they launched the world's first hydrogen act, focusing on the hydrogen vehicle, charging station infrastructure, and also define the safety requirement and the role of the government agency. And they now have launched three hydrogen power city already. They have all hydrogen production, distribution in this city, and they plan to expand it up to 30% of the city and county and towns in that country by 2040. This is very, very aggressive plan, but it's happening already in our Asian country. China, of course, they are also doing the same with many provinces. And if you follow the news, a couple of years ago, many years ago, actually, they launched the first hydrogen fuel cell tram. And that is the one of the heavy transportation for the mass transportation. And in terms of the technology, the request, yeah, here I would like to show you why we have some of the known technology in the market to produce all three types of hydrogen. We need lots more. We need to still need to increase electrolysis capacity to cope up with the surplus electricity from the renewable energy. We have to reduce the price of the material, try to find another option, which is cheaper and also easier to produce, okay? And also find another technology to use renewable energy to produce green hydrogen. And if you can see in this picture, you can see that on the right-hand side, this is the technology which is launched in deploy already in the market, but we have a lot more in the pipeline making by us, right? And we they are all have high potential, but how we can push this through the valley of death, try to make it work in the market, right? So in Asia, the situation, we have the a lot of patent activity, but the major activity is led by Chinese Patent Office. And but by number of the patent files, nowadays Asia Pacific has the highest number among other regions in the world. Of course, led by China, but it shows how aggressive we are. And also, I want to point out that the most of the patent application comes from the materials and chemicals company. So it means that material is kind of the key for the technology push. To drive the technology to the market. But anyway, we cannot do anything without the policy drive. We need the collaboration from all stakeholders like government, energy company, and also scientists like us. to participate in the hydrogen supply chain. And also among, not only by this among these stakeholders, but among many countries as well. The good example we can see from Australia that collaborate with Japan and South Korea to create the supply lines of the hydrogen. All right, so for the CCUS scheme, it's now still the big challenge in terms of cost, because they said that it's just like something that the plant, the energy production plant have to pay extra to have it. So now they have to think if it is worth doing, right? To cope up with this, we have to maximize the use of carbon dioxide to create the value. So the CCS will become more cost effective, right? This is simple equation. And if we can solve the problem on the CCS uncertainty and operation risk, we can help to reduce the production cost of the hydrogen. Okay, and the new technology focus nowadays is the direct air capture. So they use CCUS to capture the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And because this is the way to towards not only the net zero emission, but negative emission, right? So this is the frontier technology that created by the basic science. For the carbon dioxide, we have plenty of application we can go for, but the global challenge, not only in Asia or in Europe, the technology, commercial and social readiness level. Okay, so we have to make this all together, not only the technology, but how ready the commercial, the market is and the society is, we have to take care of. And also the driving policy and public awareness, right? And for the high TRL or technology, readiness level technology, we need the policy and support or subsidizing policy to drive the industry to use it. Okay, and as I said, now the big question for the CCUS scheme is it worth doing? And if they invest to pay, if they pay to have the CCUS unit in the plant, in the industry, and short later, the green hydrogen becomes so cheap and cost effective. So this make the user, like industry, hesitate to adopt the CCUS in their production. But the way to go is now is a trend that we many countries try to encourage to create the hubs among the many industrial sector in the ecosystem to reduce the cost. And it's not really the cost, just like share the cost and operation risk together. So that is the way to go for the world. But anyway, we need the government and the stakeholder to accelerate this in the short term and also support the CCS and green hydrogen in the long term. Right, in Europe and North America, they start already. Asia need to catch up. We can, we might be slow, but we cannot wait for too long. We will see it in a couple of years or not more than 10 years later. And some of the country in the region start already, like Australia, China, Japan, they are a good model. And of course, many other countries in Asia will try to do the same. And for sure, now carbon capture market is already active, because it's very suitable for refinery and upstream fuel production in the big country like China and India. All right, so I hope that I can give you, can reflect you the importance of the basic science to improve energy efficiency, decarbonized electricity, energy storage, electrification approach, and carbon dioxide management. And not only from the point of view from scientists, but also from the one who have to work with the industry at the nowadays. And not only to save our environment and to encourage the business growth, but also to make the world sustainable, to make the livable community and to have a better life quality. And I thank you for your interest, and I'm sorry for the technical hiccups in my presentation. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Professor. You forgot to introduce yourself, as you said, you promised at the beginning. So now it's open to questions. So feel free to drop your questions in the chat for those who are online. Question can be addressed to the panelists, also from Dr. Amal from UNESCO, or to Monsieur Spiro depuis Paris. So it's up to you. Yes, of course.
So just to break the ice, perhaps I start with the first question. So thank you very much to all these presenters who gave very nice aspects of the issue of energy and the link between energy and development and basic sciences. But one issue has only been mentioned on the sideline in the last talk, in fact, and that is the question of intellectual property. Because as soon as new things are invented, people tend to get patents on them and so on. And especially in an audience like here, where we're also thinking a lot about developing countries, I'm often wondering, is this something good or bad? Is this hindering, in fact, the development and the use of basic science advances that people immediately claim intellectual property on discoveries which might come? So I would like to have a bit an opinion of people here on if say for Africa or for Asia, it is good or bad if new discoveries are immediately patented and become property.
So thanks. So anyone would like to take the question? Professor Catlow?
Well, I'm an ECV. Sorry, I can't offer any great. I mean, it's an excellent question. And it is the same kind of dilemma that's faced with drug discovery. That on the one hand, protecting intellectual property is an incentive, particularly for the involvement of commercial organisation. And context that we will need very extensive involvement of industry in the things we've been talking about today. So you do need, particularly when you're talking about industry, you do need the incentive. But then when this new technology, which is developed that can alter lives, is restricted because of intellectual property, it does become a problem. I think it's an area where governments really need to get involved. So I'm not really offering an answer, but I'm really saying that I think you are highlighting an important issue. But there isn't a simple answer. So particularly if we want, as we will need, investment and involvement from both small and large scale industry. But I don't know whether Patchanita has got some thoughts on that.
So if I may share, I would say that it depends on the business model of that type of technology. So for example, if I invent something, discover something, and I don't know how to use it, and I patent it. And then one day someone saw it and asked me, like they want to develop it further so they can make money. And if I say, I make it cheap for you. So it means that I allow the technology to be transferred and I will help them. So that is okay. I think that it is kind of fair for the inventor. Like, and then it can be kind of the stage that the inventor can see that they will not be kicked off from the loop. If that will make the progress happen, it's okay. The development happen, it's okay. But if I say that, I can say that this is very valuable, right? I mean, the industry really need it, right? I make it very expensive. So it's not feasible right? So I don't think the industry will buy it, and then it will die there. And that is also the part that the scientists may have to think of. They might want to, I believe that they might want to see their technology to be used rather than to hug it on the bed at home, something like that. So it is a balance, I would say. Like, it may be okay if it may make it clear when you work together, but it may be not okay if you try to squeeze it in your arms all the time. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, we're not really offering solutions, but I think you have raised something that will need a discussion. I think Panchanita offered more solutions than I did.
Oh, just example.
Are you satisfied?
There's something in the chat, I think, Stephane.
Yes. So before I take you, they say, oh God. My Zoom just stopped, so I cannot read. Ah, so there's a Inko who is actually pessimistic about being able to decarbonize in time to curb the worst climate change effect or societal collapse. And then he's asking, he's pessimistic about the fact that the emission will stop to rise. And he thinks that as a result of the fact that energy company do not have sufficient incentive to stop using fossil fuel, and that government seems unable to resist their lobbying effort. He thinks that the emission will continue and then more fossil fuel projects are planned in the future in contradiction to CO2 pledge. So how do you see this contradiction? Or, Dr. Patchanita, I will start with you trying to answer this question because you have been working more closely to the industry. What do you think?
I try to formulate my the answer in the neutral way because if we talk about government, right, people say the government never done enough, right? And maybe it's true. And what I can see, at least from my experience in Asia, because we don't have the aggressive action plan and solid, like we don't consolidate the whole scheme. I can see the leap from the industry, really. They cannot wait. They have to, as I put in the first slide, I put that industry got the pressure. I don't, because I don't see that the government got a lot of pressure in action, because they claim that by 2050 the country will be like this, but they cannot control because it, and they do not have enough money to make it all for the whole country as well. So the drive, I can say the drive might come from industry, but the policy making part and support from the public have to be created by the government. Yeah, and I agree with you that I agree that there is some contradiction in this, but the country who can make the collaboration between the government and the private sector most productive or most fruitful will see the good consequence from this. Yeah, because the government has they cannot, I understand them too, they cannot put one rule for the whole country, and the private sector has to do this because of the profit, yes, but they need the cost, but the cost can be subsidized or can be supported by some policy. So they have to drive together, but by different tools. I don't know if I answered the question, but this is from my point of view.
Could I just comment briefly?
Yes, sure.
I mean, I agree with what Panchanita has just said. I think I understand the question. I'm not as pessimistic about the energy companies.
the energy companies want to be there for the long term. I mean, they're not fools. They know that in the long term, they will have to replace fossil fuels as a source of energy by renewables. And I think a lot of them will want to be leaders in renewables. So I do understand the question, but I don't think we should be quite as pessimistic. We need to engage with them, and they need to be absolutely clear that what government policymakers and society want is this transformation. But they will; these big companies will want to be there in 50 years' time. But you know, I do just want to repeat: I do understand the concerns that are expressed in that question.
Hi. I'm not a scientist, so I'm going to make an observation as an administrative member of staff. What I seem to have understood from this afternoon's talk is that maybe we need more basic science researchers to sit on the decision-making table and actually get into politics somehow. And then, you know, maybe they will be able to make decisions themselves, you know, and convince the people that they are working with. But maybe I'm saying something very, very obvious. Or,
if yeah. I was your professor, I had to grade you, I would have given you 100 over 100. So that's the great solution.
I don't think it's, maybe it's not that easy, but you know, some scientists might decide to sacrifice some of their research time and work for this global energy crisis or for a sustainable development that might actually take place if they are there.
This is to comment quickly. This is what I showed in the last slide when I gave the overview in Africa. So there, the need is urgent, right? You need scientists. Usually scientists try to, get away from decision-making sphere, but this is impossible. You cannot achieve development if you don't talk with decision makers. In many countries, even the president doesn't have a scientific council. It doesn't exist in many countries. This is why taking decision about science is very difficult. If you ask, there's a big professor from Cameroon here. I can ask the Professor Wafo, what is the budget dedicated to science in Cameroon? I'm not sure it's even 0.001% of the gross domestic product. So, the way we define the science policy have to change drastically. I mentioned it, Professor Kagame was here and he understood what is the use of basic science? He was sitting here. And then people like Sandro Scandolo or Fernando Covedo could advise him about what to do. And then he's doing it in Rwanda, and then Rwanda is booming. So you're absolutely right. So how to get to the decision makers? It's quite impossible in many countries.
But isn't this also where organizations like the IAP have got a role to play, linking the scientific community, we hope, to policy formulation? I mean, I agree with you that we want to get an individual scientist, actually, some going into political careers.
If I may say some
organizations like IAP.
Can you hear me? If I may say something, I agree with you, Richard, that academies have a great role to play to advise governments, and this might not be enough. This is Michel Spiro speaking. Sorry.
Sorry.
Do you hear me?
Yes.
Okay.
We can hear you.
But I want to also emphasize that there is already a step in that direction at the global level, which was started by the climate scientists by setting up the IPCC, the International Panel on Climate Change, which was explicitly to connect scientists to governments. And this is repeated again with biodiversity. Now there is the IPBES, maybe for energy, we would need to have such a kind of panel where governments and scientists could discuss issues connected to the global change for energy producing and energy use. I agree that this is lacking because it is behind the climate, but it's a specific issue, the energy, which is a major issue. And probably we would need a kind of panel where scientists and politicians can meet together to see the possible approach for solutions for the addressing the global energy crisis.
Yeah, thank you. It needs to be at a global level rather than just as an individual nation state or even regional level. So
I have a question from Karim.
Oh, hello. Thank you very much. So as the issue is developing countries, I mean, myself as a potential consumer of Mother Nature in developing countries, I think that there are plenty of issues like failures within the energy system that need to be handled. I think the energy system are open to the environment, and they are open to society. So the environment, they are exposed to natural disasters. In society, they are exposed to man-made disasters like cyber attacks, like, you know, industrial failures. We've seen the case in 1998 in New Zealand, where 6 weeks of failure within the system were quite heavy for a city like Auckland, let alone thinking about Cameroon or Douala. So I'm thinking whether basic sciences is within the community, you guys are thinking of building from the right start a resilient system. And if you can comment on this.
No. Why don't you go?
Karim, I didn't hear the last expression.
I wasn't quite sure what
I was talking about. A resilient energy system from the right beginning. I mean, that would minimize the failures. I'm not talking about resiliency in terms of, it seems like, I mean, the interaction between the science and the policy is hopeless. We have two types of evidences. I mean, scientific thinking and contextual. So, I mean, if we would like to avoid failures within the system, take Thailand, for instance. I wonder whether the power plant that they have has a system by which if there is any flood or whatsoever, the system would
I mean, work. You're absolutely right. Building in resilience into the system is of key importance. And that is I think you mentioned this, didn't you, Stefan? Is one of the challenges when you become dependent, increasingly dependent on renewables.
Want to comment? Ah, okay, it's coming.
Masks.
Yeah, I have a. Even if you leave aside the political difficulties of moving to renewable energy, I just want to ask a technical question to you as a scientist.
Sorry, what question do you want to ask?
Leaving aside the question of political will and, you know, making governments to do. Move to renewable energy, leaving that aside. At the technical level, I just want to ask, if I understand roughly the numbers, currently only 15% of the energy budget of the world comes from renewable energies. And do you think is there a technically feasible roadmap to move 100% to, is that a technically feasible? Is this a solution that is technically feasible and given the current state of renewable energy technology?
I'll pass over to Panchanita because she actually talked more about the technology than I did. But I think it is feasible. The point that both I and she and I were making is we haven't got the technology now. And this is why we need, I think this is one of the most important things about this meeting, we need the basic science to give us the technology to allow us to do this in 30 years' time. But I think it is a feasible ambition. But I think it'd be very good if I don't want to put you on the spot, Patchanita, but I mean, you commented more about the range of technologies available.
Yeah. So if we look up our situation at the moment, and see that one day we will not need the renewable, the fossil fuel at all. It looks really difficult, I admit. But I would say that I did mention in my presentation as well that why we are now talking about how the basic science can contribute significantly in the energy crisis. Anyway, at this moment, for I don't know how many years, but for a significant number of years, the fossil fuel and coal, which is known to be dirty, you know, has to be the backbone for why in this transition period. But the point is whether or not we will, by this time, with doing, with improving the renewable energy seriously or not. If we know that the fossil fuel is polluted, we need it, we use it now, but we don't do anything at all, we will be so far from being to get that 100%. But if we start doing now, I from my point of view, that I think that 100% renewable energy can may be able to be done only in some region. We will see in this our generation, we will see some country can do that, but some country is so far away from being able to do that. They don't have even the budget to take care of the hunger in their country. How can they invest in that, right? But that is the integration of all the issue that one country have to focus on. So I think that anyway, we have to put this in a priority and do our best. And in COP26, for example, we talk in the very peaceful way that, oh, the world will rise together, right? But in at the same time, the developed country, the country which is have their developed energy scheme also feel or a little bit complain that, hey, why we have to help the country which doesn't do anything, right? But the reason of not doing anything because we have many reasons, right? So I think the best is we try our best to do that. And in industry, part of it, I can see that they want to see the catalog of the technology. The one of the popular question is, do you have the catalog of the promising technology that we can choose with price, with payback point, something feasibility study? And the scientist doesn't have that, right? We create a frontier technology. We said that, oh, it's promising, it's best, but who will calculate that? So that is a huge gap, and this is a big part of the value of the valley of debt that I mentioned in my presentation. That, for example, the first question from the audience talked about the IP. That is a little part of that. We have the IP coverage or not? It's not as big issue as how to transfer that technology to the real use. That is the bigger gap between academic and industry that we also, as a scientist, I think we can help a lot in this. And the rest has to be have to rely on the government and other stakeholders as well. So for example, we can, I see many good examples from the, because I was graduate from Germany, right? So I see the good example from the as a white paper, right? That is made by academic and industry sectors. So they come and discuss together and then analyze the supply chain of particular technology and to analyze whether or not the country is ready. Or if we are, or if we should do it now, where is the supplier and access to do that. I think that is the good practice many every country should have.
Just a quick additional comment that as well as renewables, we do have nuclear, which is not renewable, but which is low carbon. And that shouldn't be forgotten.
No, actually, my question was exactly that. Do you see any role for nuclear? I mean, is it, can we actually reach the no carbon goal?
I can't with the mask on.
Do you think that nuclear will continue to play a role if you want to go to no carbon goals by 2050? Or do you think it's, what is the, in the mix, what do you see the role?
Well, in my view, nuclear should continue to play a role. It's a low carbon technology. It's not, this will be in an extended transition period, but nuclear for providing appreciable contribution to the electricity base load, I think will continue to play a role.
Got a question, comment? So I have a question to our friends in Paris, both to Michel and Amal. So Michel, I start with you. So I've seen that among the supports of this International Year for Basic Science, we mostly find institutions, research centers, or academias, and so on and so forth. So what about your interactions with government, right? How do you think government can assimilate, right, the plan that you have behind? By the way, I'm a good friend of Luc Alemán, so I know a bit how it started, how you looked for partners. So how do you intend, let's say, to make states, right, to join you in celebrating this year, not only to celebrate, but to implement what you have in mind in your agenda?
Sorry, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So first, the process to get the International Year proclaimed was in close relationship with many states. It started at UNESCO in 2019, where the project was brought to the UNESCO agenda for a recommendation for an International Year to be proclaimed by the United Nations. This was brought up by Jordan, Russia, Vietnam, Nigeria, and some others, and was unanimously endorsed by all UNESCO members. And there was a lively discussion where people, where delegations at UNESCO were supporting this project. Then it came to the United Nations. The decision for the proclamation was brought on the agenda of the United Nations General Assembly by Honduras Republic, but was co-sponsored by 30 countries. Most of them were developing countries and not the developed ones. Only Japan was one of the developed countries sponsoring the resolution, but finally it was endorsed unanimously also at the United Nations General Assembly on December 2nd. So all the process to get the proclamation of the International Year was in connection between the steering committee, so the unions and the academies, and the governments, first the delegations at UNESCO and then the delegations at the UN General Assembly. By the way, we are still in mind to organize a side event at the UN General Assembly during this International Year. Whether we will be able to do that or I don't know yet, but we have in mind to organize during this International Year also a side event. And we are also in mind to push for a decade after this International Year, because it's not only during 1 year that we will be able to achieve the goals that we have in mind and which were repeated by Amal Kasri, to be more inclusive, to be more collaborative for sustainable development, to have a multicultural dialogue, to give a role, to empower women and diversity in this adventure, to promote open science, because as Richard said, for this goal, which is a global goal, we need to be open. I understand that the private sector needs to make some profit, so we have a bit of a compromise to find. To be more efficient, we need to be collaborative, but to develop incentive, we need to associate the private sector, and the incentive might be patents, so we have to discuss this during the International Year. But it is clear that we will try to set up some indicators, how much basic sciences could be more funded, could serve education, and could be mobilized for the sustainable goal agenda. We will set up indicators, and in order to see the progression of these indicators, we will try to promote a decade of basic sciences, as it was done, by the way, for OCEAN. So there is already an example that we can follow. So if we succeed to get this side event and the UN and to get a decade for basic sciences. We will certainly use this to promote the more connection between scientists and governments. Taking the example, as I said, of IPCC, which is doing very well, of now for biodiversity also, but we need to have other examples in other sectors of the sustainable goal development agenda to set up a more connection between the scientists and the governments. So this is one of the objectives of the International Year of Basic Sciences for Sustainable Development.
Thank you very much. So Dr. Kasri, I just want a comment from you, just 1 minute, because we close in 5 minutes. So, I mean, UNESCO is involved in capacity building a lot on the continent, right? But if you observe the African continent, we need more than that. For example, we need 1 million more scientists, right? PhD trained, right? The young scientists on the continent to achieve the SDG goals. So how do you think that UNESCO can help via science engagement, for example, right, to create more vocation for science? Because you see, the continent is more immediate innovation driven, right? So how do you think you can help? Is there any agenda for that? Or just
yes, absolutely. Thank you, Stephane, for the question. So yes, of course, Africa is a priority for UNESCO. And we have a lot of programs. Three of our work plans for this biennium are actually indicating Africa as a priority for us. Currently, the International Year of Basic Science is a great opportunity to establish new initiatives in Africa. And in fact, we are working on two initiatives right now with negotiating with several partners. One of them was CNRS here in France with the University, Lorraine University in Nancy, in order to equip researchers and scientists in Africa with the single crystal X-ray diffractometers, which are very sophisticated and very expensive techniques. And we will train them in remote, how to use this remotely. And actually, this is through open labs. This is just an example. I'm mentioning this as an example. And we have another initiative as well. And we will do both of those and hopefully more under the umbrella of the International Year. So we will use this chance for this. And just commenting on your first question, thanks, Michelle, for answering. We will take the opportunity of the opening ceremony to bring actually the policymakers. So you mentioned, you asked about how the government can be involved in this. And we will bring the ministers of science and technologies together with the scientists in order to discuss with them how the policy can be developed in each country in order to support and raise the profile of basic science. And of course, these initiatives that I mentioned will be also used as examples during these discussions in order to convince or at least understand how the government or what they think about in order to raise the profile of basic sciences in Africa. We have already confirmed ministers from several parts around the world, and Africa, of course, will be heavily involved by scientists and policymakers from Africa. So yes, we have a lot of ambitious plans for Africa, and we hope we can build also on some of the achievements through the previous international years, like International Year of Crystallography and International Year of Light. There were actually previous achievements that we are trying to build on right now. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So any other comment? We are closing soon. So Atish, you want to give the closing remarks? Thank you.
Okay, so thank you very much, Professor Catlow and Professor Thamyongkit, for this very informative session. I think it's a good way to start the ICTP's participation in the international year. I would like to also tell you that within the context of this international year, the next event will be held on 23rd of June. It will be a session on artificial intelligence for detection and attribution of climate extremes. So I hope to see you, all of you, then. And please join us now for some light refreshments on the terrace. Thank you very much.